About him being faithful, and he is. There are so many things in our lives that we think we can rely on that when push comes to shove, we can't. You know that even our clock, that 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, you know, every now and then, every few years, they have to make an adjustment to the atomic clock, because if they didn't, after hundreds of years, it would be off just a fraction of a second every year. And after hundreds of years, summer would be winter, and vice versa. They have to adjust even the clock, so you can't even count on your clock. Some of you, you know, thought you could always count on that job, and something happened. Some of you thought you could always count on a relationship, and something happened. Well, let me tell you, he's faithful. You can count on him. When everything else in life fails you, you can count on him. He is faithful. So I want to pray for you. If you're here this morning, you say, Pastor David, I've got a need. I need faithful God to show up in my life. Would you just slip your hand up? I want to pray for you. Lord, you see these hands all across this room. Lord, things in our lives that we thought were going to be faithful, things in our lives that we thought weren't going to let us down, have let us down. Systems, jobs, relationships. But God, you're faithful. You're faithful. Your word says that even when we're faithless, you're faithful because you can't disown yourself. And so we lean into you. We lean into your faithfulness. We trust you in our situation, in our circumstances. We give it all to you right now. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, Lord, would you just do what only you can do? We'll give you the glory for it. In Jesus' name, we thank you for it. Amen and amen. God bless you as you're seated. Once again, happy Father's Day. I'm glad that you're here. I don't know about you, but I am so enjoying this series. This is my story, and we've just been blessed. Man, a few weeks ago, you heard from Ollie, his incredible story, and then we talked to James, his powerful story. Chip shared his story with you a couple of weeks ago. We got to watch online, which I'm so thankful for online church, that even when I'm halfway around the world, I can worship with my church family. And then last week, wow, Liz's story was so powerful and impactful. And I'm just going to tell you, if you haven't seen all of those, go back, find it. They're on our Facebook page on that feed. They're also on our YouTube channel, which I think, somebody help me, is youtube.com/Bloomington Cornerstone. Is that right? I'm looking back. Yes, that's right. youtube.com/Bloomington Cornerstone. Check out all those incredible stories. And it's so fun to hear from people in our church that are our friends and we don't know their story. If you've got a testimony, got a couple weeks left to share your testimony. So reach out to me. We've got a couple of slots. And you say, well, I couldn't sit up there and share my story over 45 minutes. That's okay. We've got a couple of 5 and 10 minute slots over the next couple of weeks. We would love to hear your story, your testimony. So reach out to me if you've got a testimony that you would like to share. But I'm excited this morning to welcome my friend John Laskowski to the platform. Would you welcome John as he comes? In first service, I told the story, you know, I grew up watching and loving Indiana basketball, I know John played IU basketball. I'll talk about that in just a second. I don't have a lot of memories of him playing because I was so young, but my memories growing up were as a kid watching him on TV. How many of you remember John on Channel 4 broadcasting the IU game? So that was kind of where I remembered John, and I'll never forget, we moved to town, we started the church about 12 years ago. On a Sunday morning, John showed up, and I was kind of giddy. Like, I was kind of fangirl a little bit. John Laskowski's at church today, right? And I thought, man, what a big deal. And turns out he's just a regular guy, and he's become a great friend. And he just stepped off of our board just this last business meeting. Served on our board for about 6 years, and just been a great friend of the church. And I've gotten to walk a part of his faith journey with him over the last several years, and so I'm excited to hear his story. But John, we all know you from IU basketball and now from Culver's. You're wearing the shirt today. Go back. Tell us about the beginning of your life, because you didn't grow up as like a child of privilege and all that. Tell us about your growing up years.
No, not at all. From South Bend, Indiana. In fact, the west side of South Bend, Indiana, that's the poor side of town.
That's the wrong side of town, right?
That's where all the Polish people live.
Laskowski's Italian, right?
It is not. but it's mom and dad, and we lived there. I had three younger brothers, and my dad passed away when I was 8 years old. He was a diabetic and had bad kidneys, no dialysis machines in the early 60s, and he passed away. My mom raised us four boys. She worked as a receptionist, a little Social Security from dad still, and made about $1,000 a month. Three-bedroom house, one bath, and that was it. That was our life, just trying to get by day to day.
You said you and your brothers fought over the meat at dinner, right?
Yeah, you got one piece of meat, and we'd fight over that. Everybody got one piece. You're not eating that. I'm going to take that. You know, we all that's all we had. So very meager beginning. It was time to decide. I love sports, you know, because I didn't have a dad. So the coaches in my life have been very important to me. Little league coach, my basketball coaches. I was too skinny to play football, so I was trying to decide which high school to go to. I went to a public grade school, and the public high school where all the kids were going to go was very good in basketball. Won the sectional, won the regional, went to the semi-state. Man, I said, those guys are good. And I thought about the Catholic school, and they were 4-16. I said, now there's opportunity. And so I talked my mom into sending me to the Catholic school where I'd have a chance. And, you know, I talked to my freshman coach in high school years later, and he said, we kept 20 kids on that team. You were the 17th best player.
Okay? Wow.
I averaged 1.5 points a game my freshman year on the freshman team. Okay? And Bob Knight had never heard of me.
I think we got a picture of you playing at St. Joseph's so long ago they didn't even have color yet.
It was
so
black and white. That's me, 34, 6'5", 165 pounds. And, and that's my high school coach was back to me. He was a big influence in my life as well. And so
so you progressed over high school, got better. You didn't finish averaging a point and a half a game.
Yeah, my
so.
Senior year in high school, I averaged 29 points a game.
Wow.
So that was quite an improvement. And at the time, you know, I'm not a believer that God has watched you. He's formed you in your mom's womb. He has a plan for your life. I'm just enjoying being a basketball player and thinking where this could get me to go.
So not following Jesus, just kind of following whatever door opens, and a pretty big door opens.
Yes, so Bob Knight gets the job at Indiana in 1971. And have you got that picture, Nathan? Yeah. Look at that. That is my kitchen in South Bend. Every kitchen had those floral drapes in the early 70s. I am 17 years old. That's the only tie and jacket I own. And that is Bob Knight. He's 30 years old with a green jacket and a green shirt, coming to talk to me to go to Indiana. And he had just gotten the job, and he was looking for a 6'5" guard forward, and that was my position. And I was so excited to have him there, and I find out years later, I was the third choice for that position. The first guy went to UCLA, the second guy really slapped him, he went to Purdue, and I'm the third guy, okay? So about 5 years ago, I see the guy who went to UCLA, Pete Trigovich. And I said, Pete, I want to take you out for a steak dinner. I said, if you'd have taken that position, nobody'd ever heard of me. Thank you so much. It worked out good.
So you were the third choice for that scholarship. Yep. And then played, this was Bob Knight's first recruiting class, right? His first year. Talk about that journey, playing for IU. I think
so
we've got a few pictures to go through. Yeah.
Unbelievable. Let's look at some pictures there. That's playing in South Bend against Notre Dame, okay? The local team. And you see how quickly I got around that guy. Huh? Here's another one. So this is a picture of me at the free throw line, and that is against Purdue. That's the last game of the year. If this free throw goes in,
we're gonna point out that guy right there, right?
Indiana wins the game, and we are the Big Ten champions. That teammate of mine has a towel around his face. He cannot watch what's about to happen.
You have a lot of confidence in your free throw
shooting. Yeah, he goes,
ability,
oh
right?
My gosh, they put that guy up there? And here's the next picture. This is 20 seconds later, okay? That's him right there, okay? Now they've stormed the floor, the cheerleaders are there, and he's my best buddy right there. He's with me all the way, see?
And that's somebody they know. That's Jim
Cruz,
right?
Yeah. See, he's a coach in college. He lives up in Indy now, and I showed him that picture. He about died. He just died.
I couldn't watch.
I showed that to him, yeah. So it was a great time to be at Indiana, Coach Knight. We had winning teams. As you older folks remember, those were the games when you turned Indiana on, they were going to win the game, and we did.
Mm-hmm.
We did.
Yeah, great time. Yeah. So, you're still not following the Lord. So, but you come through IU and then get an opportunity to play in the pros. Talk about that draft story, because it's a little different than what people picture today.
Yeah. So the NBA draft, you know, like I'm just an average college player. I'm not special, you know, but.
Well, let's back up for just a second. Let's show them the Sports Illustrated, because there is something a little special about that. So yeah.
Well, as a matter of fact, who's heard of Sports Illustrated magazine? Okay, yeah. That's me. Okay. yeah, that's pretty special. February 3rd, 1975. Now, what it says there is super sub. So I was not even good enough to be on the starting five at Indiana. Okay, and there's like 325 teams in America, and they all have starting fives, and I'm not a starter. Okay. But I started thinking about that, especially after I became a believer in 92, that God gave me special talents, just like he has you, talents and abilities, and my job was to come off the bench. And it was so unique that the sports writer for Sports Illustrated had never seen that, because all the best players got to play, you know, right away. They were starters. He goes, how can this kid come off the bench and keep playing every year for 3 years? And that's how it worked out, and it was so special to him. He put me on the cover of Sports Illustrated, and I still get about 20 of those in the mail each year. Self-addressed stamp envelope return with a felt pen. Please sign this and send it to me.
I've got one on my office wall, so I didn't mail it to you, but I got one on my office
wall. I've got
a
couple in the Culver's in Seymour and the Culver's in Bloomington now as well.
Yeah, so talk about the NBA draft. Yeah.
So what do you do after you get a degree from Indiana? You get a job, okay? I get a job in Indianapolis. I'm working. I've been a month there. And the boss comes by, and he says, hey, have you seen the afternoon paper? There used to be an afternoon paper in Indianapolis. I said, no. He plops it on my desk, and right there in the sports page, it says, Laskowski drafted by NBA Bulls in second round. I read it in the paper that I was in the NBA. Now, today, you take your posse with you, and you go to New York, and you get a table, and they give you a hat, and you walk out there and meet the committee. I read it in the paper. Okay? That was the difference. Now, here's my mom making $10,000 a year, and my first year in the NBA, I made $50,000, and they sent a signing bonus check in the mail for $10,000. In one day, I made as much as she made in a year, okay? And thought, wow, this is like unbelievable. Is life great or not?
Tell me, I think one time you told me about one really good game you had against a pretty well-known person in the NBA.
So when I was in high school, I had a picture of Pete Maravich on my wall. And he was a very flamboyant player, long hair, floppy socks. He averaged 44 points a game for LSU 3 years in a row.
Wow.
Now, his dad was the coach, so that helped a little. But it's like, how can a guy score 44 points a game without a three-point shot? Wasn't invented yet. And so now I'm in the NBA and playing with the Bulls, and we have a game against New Orleans Jazz, the team Pete played for. Okay, and he's guarding me, and I'm guarding him. I'm like, this is unbelievable. So the Jazz decided to run a special on tickets that day, okay? I mean, the Superdome is a huge place, all right? And for $1, you could buy a seat in the balcony, okay? For $1, everybody decided to do that. 35,000 people showed up, the largest crowd in NBA history at the time, okay? And there's me, and I'm a rookie, and there's Pete Maravich, my idol. I'm thinking, this is really good. And so every once in a while, you have a game that's like unbelievable, okay? And you start throwing shots up that aren't supposed to go in, and they go in, okay? And that's what happened to me. I got 28 points. They took Pete Maravich out of the game in the fourth quarter because he couldn't guard me. We win the game. And the coach comes over. He walks me off the floor. He says, kid, that was a great game. He said, we got to go celebrate. He said, have you ever had raw oysters? I said, of course not. He didn't know my background. I said, of course not. And we went to the Pearl Oyster Bar, and they were shucking oysters, and I tell you, it was a great, great day, great memory.
28 points against Pete Maravich.
Yeah,
that's pretty good.
That?
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
So fast forward a little bit. So you graduate, you play in the NBA for a few years, and then you get a job, and you're just kind of living the life, right?
Yeah, I get a job, and I'm working, a sales guy, you know, and life's going on, and And then Coach Knight calls and says, hey, you want to be on TV? And I said, Coach, I'm pretty shy. You know that. I don't know much about TV. I said, what do you have to do to be on TV? He said, well, when the red light comes on, start talking. Hey, I didn't know it was that easy. And I was in TV, but I knew what was going on. And little by little, I gained more confidence on how to announce. And for, I don't know, 12, 13 years, Chuck Marlowe and I did those games on TV. And it was just a real treat. The play-by-play position is pretty easy, or it's very hard because you got to run the broadcast and do commercials, that kind of stuff. The color commentator, he kind of answers questions, kind of like what Dave's doing, and it makes it pretty easy because I knew, you know, I had been there, know what I was talking about. And so in 1992, a friend of mine invited me to a lunch, and it was a Christian speaker talking about how God, Jesus came into his life and he accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. And a wonderful thing started happening to his business, and he would spend eternity in heaven. I said, that sounds like a great deal to me. And so for the last 30 years, I've been a believer in the Lord. And that summer of 92, Coach and I called and said, look, Chuck's getting a little old. And he said, I want to have a new play-by-play guy, the hard job. And he said, I want you to do that for me. I said, Coach, I can't do that. That's, you know. He said, I'll see you at Notre Dame in 5 days. Of course, it's Notre Dame, you know. You guys play Notre Dame. So I called that friend of mine who invited me to that lunch, and I said, I am in big trouble. I said, I'm going to be on statewide TV with the largest rated, locally produced sports show in America, and I have no idea what I'm going to do, okay? I said, you need to drive up there with me, and you need to pray all the way. And we drove to South Bend. And it worked out pretty good. I called the TV station the next day, and I said, what'd you think of the game? And they said, well, you did much better than we thought you would. Now that's a compliment. That's a compliment. They had me down here, I was at least alive.
As long as you set your expectations low enough, you're good. That's right.
And for the next 10 years, Ted Kitchen and I did the games on TV, and I still have comments today about how much fun people had watching us and enjoying the broadcast. So people around Indiana are starting to get to know me from my playing days and now from my broadcasting days, that this guy is a pretty sharp guy and loves Indiana basketball.
Yeah, that's awesome. So, and then you get a job in insurance, you're working in insurance. Talk to me about that journey. You become a believer, and tell me how, kind of the story of how you ended up at Cornerstone.
So life is good, you know. I've got a good job. I'm on TV. I'm a local celebrity. I mean, come on. God is not in my life yet in the 80s, but now starting in the 90s, it's like, man, this thing's really good. I got a job at the IU Alumni Association. That was a natural for them because people around, alumni around the country knew me, and I would start to travel, and that led to another job as at Marsh McLennan Insurance Company. And things were going good, but I thought life was just, you know, we've heard about stories here that God has done wonderful things to recover people, make people better, and that's wonderful, that always happens. But what about those of us who life's going good? I've got a good marriage, I've got some great kids, my wife Alice was here in the first service, and this thing is great, and I know when I die I'm going to go to heaven, so let's just keep riding her out, you know? Don't make any waves. And I was here, we moved back to Bloomington. My wife worked for the Pacers, we lived in Indy, and we moved here. And in 2010, we moved back. And Alice had a friend who's here, Diane Smith. And she knew Diane and said, Alice, we got this little local church. It's not as big as the ones you've been to in the past, but why don't you come try the church out? And so Alice came and said, why don't you give us Cornerstone a try? And I said, well, you know, I'm not too excited about a small church. I've always gone to big churches. She said, well, there's a pastor there who plays golf. I said, really? I said, I play golf. And she said, he's really pretty good. And I said, well, I'm pretty good too. Let's go to that church, okay? Who else decided to come to Cornerstone because I like golf, okay? And so I got to meet Dave. We've had a wonderful friendship. One of my 5 bucket courses is Pebble Beach, and Dave and I went to Pebble Beach today with some other folks and just had a great time. And it's amazing how God can intervene in your life and get things for you that you never believed could happen.
So things are good, you got a good job, family, all of that, and you're serving the Lord, headed to heaven, all that good stuff. But then somewhere along the line, about 12 years ago, 10 years ago, God begins to kind of interrupt that story a little bit. Tell me about that journey, the kind of the Culver's journey a little bit.
And that is exactly, why don't you put that up, Nathan, okay? These are the notes from Dave's sermon, October 28th, 2012. I laminated it. I used it so much, the papers weren't, I had to laminate it so I could still pray it every day, okay? And that's it. It's teach us to pray. Some of you may have been here for that one. And the second line, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And raised Catholic, we said that every day. Hundreds, if not thousands of times in my life, I said that line. And I had no idea what it meant. And Dave went through each line that day and explained each line. That second line is, God has a plan for your life, but it just doesn't happen. Okay, you need to pray that God will show you what his plan is for your life. I already knew I had some special talents and abilities from what happened in my athletic career, but never really put that in perspective of what I could do for my business. And I started to pray that prayer that day, okay? And for a year and a half, I said that prayer, and nothing happened.
Year and a half.
And, you know, being human, I mean, that's a long time. Mm-hmm. So something's surely happened by now, God. What's the problem here, okay? I'm doing my part. What's going on with you? Well, God's time frame is a lot different. You've heard Dave talk about that. Like, he's forever and eternity, and his days are, you know, like seconds, okay? So he's taking his time. But I believe that message, and I stayed with that. And I had an office in Chicago, and I lived here in Bloomington. And occasionally I would drive up or fly up, whatever it would be, and so spend a lot of time back and forth. And I'm driving home from Chicago one day to Bloomington, and billboard sign on the highway. Just open Culver's Butterburgers and Frozen Custard. But hey, my first Culver's was 1995 in Sheboygan, Wisconsin. I'd taken the kids to IU's alumni camp in Elkhart Lake. On Friday, I treat myself and go play golf in Sheboygan. And there it is, Butterburgers and Frozen Custard, drive in. And I drive in, have no idea what this is. But I always like those little hometown mom and pop diners that have those fresh cooked burgers around, and I go to these little towns, and there was nothing like it. So I pull in there. Oh man, that was the best burger and the custard. And I'm thinking, wow, this is good. And so since 95, every time I get a chance, I would stop at Culver's and get a snack or a meal or whatever it might be. In fact, you know, there's one on Kentucky Avenue up there by 465, and I'd be coming home from Indy and I'd pass 37 to get to 67, so I get to tell you, I'm gonna stop at that Culver's. Okay, I was serious about this Culver's stuff, and I would go wherever I could. So I pulled in this Culver's in Crown Point in April of 2014, and sit at the counter there, and I'm ordering, I get my food, and the owner's there. All right. So the one thing about Culver's restaurant, like that, the owner's there. Okay, it doesn't happen at most other places, but in the Culver's world, it's very common to have the owner in the restaurant. And I'm in the Bloomington restaurant a lot, and now the Seymour restaurant, which we just opened. And he's in there. He's a sports fan. He recognizes me. He watches IU basketball. He remembers my career. He's a little older than I am. And he comes over. He starts talking. Okay, we visit. We talk about the guy who went to UCLA. He knew that guy, you know. And we had a great talk. And it's about 20 minutes, and I got a three-hour drive. And so I said, hey, good to visit with you. And he goes, hey, have you ever thought about opening a restaurant? And I looked at him and said, absolutely not. Guys lose their tail in the restaurant business. I would never do that. Nice to meet you. See you. I got in the car and I drove home. And it's a three-hour drive. And all of a sudden, you know, there's something happening to me in the head. Like, oh, wait a minute here. Wait a minute. You like Culver's? Oh, love Culver's. Yeah, absolutely. How do you know you can't be a restaurant owner? Well, because I've never owned a business. I've never worked in a restaurant. I'm not qualified to run a restaurant. Well, wait a minute now. Who could get you through all that if that's the plan for your life? I go, wait a minute. Wait, that could be it. That could be it after a year and a half. And so I get home, and I'm thinking like, ooh. So I call Fred back the next day. And I said, Fred. It's John. Yeah, I know. Well, what I didn't know was he had said that purposely because he thought I could be a good Culver's owner. And he called Craig Culver that afternoon. and said, hey, I just met a guy, and he could be the next owner of a Culver's in Bloomington, where he lives. And I said, Fred, tell me about this Culver's stuff. You know, what do you know? How do you do this? Because I didn't know what to ask. He said, well, I'll tell you what. He said, my son-in-law, we're in the porta potty business before Culver's. It was 2 a.m. in the morning, and we're cleaning porta potties. I said, kid, we got to find another business. And he sold the porta potty, and he bought a Culver's. And I said, well, I've never been that desperate, but, you know, if he could do it, maybe I could too. And it's a long process. And one of the things that Culver's has you do is they interview you as to whether to decide whether you could be a franchisee or not. You just don't give them $1 million or whatever it is at any franchise and say, hey, thanks for the money, now go run the restaurant. They interview you to see if you're the type of person that they want to have as one of their franchisees. Are you going to be in the dining room? Are you going to talk to the people? Are you going to run a nice restaurant? And unbeknownst to Craig Culver, during this interview process, he was not there, but two of the guys that were on the interview process were from Indiana. One's from Napanee and one's from outside Fort Wayne. Well, they knew who I was. They'd watched the games, they knew how I played, they saw me on TV, and one of the guys brought his family to the interview. Because the family wanted to meet me, you know. He said, hey, this is my mom, this is my wife, this is my son, just wanted to have him say hello, you know. And I'm thinking, this might be going pretty good, you know. And they selected me to be a franchisee in Bloomington.
So you feel like after a year and a half, this is the answer to the Lord's Prayer about where you're going, what His plan is for your life, your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And then after that, once you're in God's will, everything just goes perfect, right? There's no obstacles, there's no hard times, right?
No. No, no, you're in Bloomington, Indiana, my man. Okay, yep. It's a very difficult place. If any of you had a business and done any zoning and trying to build a building, it is very difficult. In fact, after I did get open, six Culver's owners came to me and said, I don't know how the heck you did it, because I applied for Culver's there, and there was no way I was going to deal with that city and work with trying to get a restaurant open. Six different guys.
Six
I'm the seventh
tried.
Guy.
Wow.
And I didn't know any different, okay? But maybe I had something they didn't have. And that was God ready to open a door, that is willing to open for me, that they couldn't get open. And it took 3 years. This is April of 14 when we get the idea. We opened in November of 18. So it took 4 years. Most Culver's own is 6 to 12 month process. They buy the land, they get approved, they get the building built, and they open 6 to 12 months, 4 years it took to get open.
Yeah, and tell me about your kind of philosophy and your heart for the business, because it's not just a business for you, right? It's more than that.
It is, you know, it's a wonderful place. Many of you have been there. Some come regularly. We've been able to hire some adults and kids from the church here, which is a great opportunity for them. They feel a good place to get that first job. We have a great opportunity. Now I have a building that can do things for good causes. All right, we had a fire, a family opened in November, and in January there was a fire in Bloomington. In January 19, a family of five, two adults, three children. One of the children passed away, died in the fire. And we heard about it, contacted the family, asked them if we could help in some way by doing a fundraiser for them one day in the restaurant. And based on that fundraiser, we did some advertising. Folks came in unbelievably, and we wrote them a check for $10,000 to help buy some food, furniture, clothes, you know, whatever they needed. And we have Bible studies that come in there. We raise money for churches and nonprofit groups. We hire. We just opened our Seymour restaurant 2 months ago. Alice, my wife, is from Seymour. Her dad was the basketball coach there in the 60s and 70s. Her mom was the English teacher. Her dad, they named the gym after her dad, the Barney Scott Gymnasium, the largest high school gym in the world, okay? He's passed away, so is his mom, her mom, but I wish they were here to see it. But we honor him by putting his picture in the wall and people can remember him. So we opened that one 2 months ago. And then my son Scott, he started with the Culver's here in Bloomington. He breaks ground tomorrow in Jasper, Indiana for our third Culver's. So he's 31 years old and he's on his way. So you pray about this thing like, what kind of dreams do I have? I mean, coming from nothing playing in Indiana, being on TV. I mean, how can life get any better? I mean, it's just, that's a perfect life, great family. But we don't dream like God does. God's got a much bigger plan for all of us. But we have to take that step. We have to go out and say, God, what is it you want me to do? As crazy as owning a restaurant is, and you saw, you heard my answer. Wait a minute here. Wait a minute. This is the answer. The second thing that Dave hadn't mentioned yet is, I don't think about restaurant sites. I mean, how do you know where to build your building? How many cars do you need to have? How much money needs to be in the area? That kind of stuff. I had a secret plan on how to get that done. I took my pastor every land site I saw and said, Dave, let's pray over this site. Let's see if this is the one. And we went to the site on West 3rd Street, on the corner where the light is, across from Master Rental. And Dave and I prayed, and guess where we are?
God opened the door.
Right there.
And isn't it fascinating, you have how many employees now between the two stores? 150?
150.
And then when Jasper opens, it'll be 225, and then who knows after that. But isn't it interesting, you know, you're trucking along, living a great life and all that kind of stuff, but God has a plan for you that's not just to bless your family, but then blesses 150 other families with jobs and income and everybody that walks in the store and all of that.
You know, you have to do your part, and your part is easy. You pray about what God wants you to be. Now, the other thing I heard about, it's a good thing Kimmy's not here, my daughter Kimmy. I can tell you, I can verify, I am the tightest guy with money in this room. I hate to spend money, okay? Because we didn't have any growing up, you know? I mean, $1,000 a month with five people. And so in 92, you know, I become a believer, and they talk about this tithing thing, you know, that if you're making this much money, you should give this much money to the church. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, that could go help to pay some bills, that could buy some food, that 10%, you know, that's that's something I really need. You know, I'm a tightwad. And then you think about it more and more, and you think about, if God can bless my 90% that's left, is that better than my 100% on my own? That didn't take long for me to figure out. I said, I'm taking the 90%, okay? And since 92, I've been tithing. And it doesn't make sense human-wise to do that. It doesn't make financial sense because you're giving away money. But spiritually, there is no doubt in my mind that we've been blessed over time by doing that and honoring God, and let alone helping the church with what they do with their money, especially
sure.
Missions. And
then connecting those dots, you know, you talk about the Lord's blessing. So Bloomington Culver's is just barely hanging on, right? There's 850 stores, 851 stores?
25 states, yeah. So, you know, like I said, I've never been in the restaurant business. Last year in Culver's World, we finished number 11 in sales.
Wow.
So it was a good year. This year, though, currently we're number 10. So we're a little bit ahead. So it's not a flash in the pan. You know, if God's behind it, he's going to make it work. And I have good people who know how to run a restaurant, because I don't really know how to do that still. But you delegate and you give them a chance to grow. Mm-hmm. And the great thing about Culver's is you can start there as a team member, work your way up to management, become a general manager, which my son Scott has done. And now he's going to be part owner of a restaurant in Jasper at 31 years old. He is so excited. I can't believe it. So we're driving down there tomorrow. I've got some friends down there, and we're going to get a picture of the groundbreaking. You can put that on his wall, and then when I'm long gone, say, man, I remember June 20th, 2022. My dad got me started, and this is my restaurant right here. So it's exciting to think about the things that, as a father, on Father's Day, you can do, but you know that it's God behind this that's making it all happen. You're just moving your feet along to make it happen, because he's not here. And that's the legacy that you
remember. Yeah, I'll never forget that day that we went to West 3rd, because we prayed on about two or three other pieces of property, and the door kept closing. Maybe the Lord closed the door, maybe the city of Bloomington closed the door, or some combination. But we get to that property on West 3rd, and we prayed, and I'll never forget, you kind of shared your heart about what you wanted this to be, and you said, I don't want this just to be a restaurant. I want this to be a place of ministry. for the employees, for the customers, and all that. And it's been cool to see that happen, how you've used it to raise money and to minister to people. So I mean, thank you for being faithful with that. And it's a tool. It's an instrument. It's a means to an end.
Exactly. It's not just a building. And, you know, my encouragement to you is, you know, if you need help, obviously we've heard stories about that, and this is a place to get help. But if life's going good, and you're as happy as you can be, you have no idea how much more happier and how much more beneficial you can be in this world if God's behind your next move instead of you just trying to figure out, well, here's the next logical thing for me to do,
right?
And I can accomplish that. It's that illogical thing that only God can accomplish that'll just wipe you off your feet, and that's exactly what's happened to us. I'm in the restaurant business. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, and it's that step, right, from praying, my kingdom come, my will be done, to your kingdom come, your will be done. And that's really, I think, the transition you made that day in October of 2012 of realizing, oh, you know, instead of praying, hey, God, bless me, Lord, let me pray about what's your will so that your kingdom comes. And could God use a restaurant for your kingdom to come in Bloomington and to be a light in Bloomington and Seymour and Jasper and wherever else the Lord may lead?
Right. So you look back 10 years ago, and it doesn't seem like a very long time in my life. You know, instead of 69, I was 59 years old. But you look forward 10 years, boy, that's a long time.
Right.
You know, at your age, whatever age you are, 10 years, oh my gosh, that's forever. Well, look where it's gotten us now in a very short time. As I look back in 10 years, look where we are, and look where my children are going to be able to be, and my grandchildren. They work in the restaurant. They're 9 and 7. They're so cute. They got little aprons. They run around. Whether they work there or not, we got college for them. We just have things that we never would have had, I think, you know, without God being there. And so this is a blessing.
Beautiful. Well, I got to ask you a question, because if I don't, people will get on me. Are we going to be any good this year?
See, people still talk about Aggie basketball. I'll tell you, it just follows me everywhere, and I love it. We are going to be better this year. Coach Woodson's doing a great job. We've got some older players with some experience. We've got some younger players with talent. I was at the camp last Wednesday, so Coach Woodson called. He's got a basketball camp going on. Mike Woodson basketball camp, 2nd to 9th grade. He said, we need tenders and fries for 150 kids. Can you bring lunch over? I said, absolutely. So we bring lunch over and got to meet the new players. Jordy Holes, a local Bloomington kid, he's back on the staff. He was here. He left Europe on Saturday. His basketball career is over. He started at IU on Tuesday. He's the recruiting coordinator now for IU, so he's back in the fold. And very excited about what's going to happen. You know, I don't miss the broadcasting. 33 years was long enough and accomplished, I think, what I needed to. I love to go to the game still and enjoy the team. But let's get back to where we were when Coach Knight was here, and things are going well.
Love it, love it. So here, let me just kind of reiterate that challenge, because I think it's really important and powerful. We've talked about, you know, people who struggle with addiction. We talked about, you know, Ollie's story, you know, Muslim family for 1,400 years, Liz's story, going through divorce, Chip's story of some struggles in church life and things like that. And it's easy to kind of sit back and kind of exempt yourself from all those conversations and go, my life's good. You know, I don't need any of this. My story's just going to be this story that's going to continue. And, you know, I want to encourage you, maybe life's good for you, but God still wants to interrupt your story. And maybe God has something better for you. Maybe God has a bigger plan for you. And, you know, maybe God would take an insurance agent and turn him into a Culver's owner and bring glory to himself because of that story. And that's really ultimately why God designed us, was two things: to be in a relationship with him and to bring glory to himself. And so, and I think, you know, that happened for you 30 years ago. You came into a relationship with Jesus, and now through this, God's bringing glory to himself because of it, because you've been willing to go, hey, this is not my story now, it's God's story. I stopped praying, my kingdom come, my will be done, and started praying, your kingdom come, your will be done. So I want to pray. Would you help me express thanks to Laz for sharing his story? And I just want to pray for you. Would you just bow your heads? Lord, I thank you for everybody in this room that calls Cornerstone their home church, for new folks, old folks alike. I thank you, God, that you interrupt our story. And I pray that we'd be sensitive to the Holy Spirit speaking to us when we've dismissed an idea as crazy. Well, that wouldn't work, or I couldn't do that. But maybe there's something of the Holy Spirit in that story prompting us to take a next step in our journey. Even though life's good, we're on our way to heaven, we're blessed, we're doing great, maybe you have a plan for us to do differently or better. And so I pray, God, that we would be sensitive to your Holy Spirit's leading in that. I thank you, God, for John's story, for his friendship, for what you're doing through him in Bloomington and Seymour, what you're going to do through Scott and Jasper, and just continue that journey. I pray, God, that you continue to bless them as they're faithful, God, that you would just bless them in return for their faithfulness as they bring glory to you through this business. And I pray, God, that there'd be other people in this room that today, they would look back on today as that moment that you began to do a work in them, that they begin to pray about what's next. What is God wanting to do in my life? What is God wanting to challenge me with? So I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Would you stand and sing that chorus with Shauna as she leads us?
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou
bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and give you peace. Have a great week. Enjoy the